بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I welcome you to another episode of our series السفرة الكرام, تجويد, the art of reciting the Quran. In our previous episode we were discussing the history of the compilation of the Quran, and we mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would personally supervise and dictate the Quran as it was revealed, and this is especially so in the Madani stage, in the stage after the Hijrah. In fact, there are many, many names, dozens and dozens of names associated with writing down the Qur'an. The most primary name that the Prophet ﷺ would employ, the most primary companion, was that of Zayd ibn Thabit. Also, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, Amr ibn al-As, so many of the companions, even Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anh, they all acted as scribes, as secretaries, if you like, who would record the Qur'an in the supervision, under the supervision of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Qur'an was written down on various materials of their time. They didn't have paper. Paper was introduced after 90 Hijrah into the Muslim lands. It was not known to them before. They would write the Qur'an on leaf parchment, on the shoulder blades of camels, on leather of camel skin, other materials. They didn't have paper until a much later stage. So they would have various scraps of the Qur'an, if you like. And in fact, it is reported, Zayd has reported to have said that we used to compile the Qur'an from scraps, like a scrapbook if you like. Because the Qur'an was not written down from A to Z in one book. It was not compiled in one book during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because there was simply no need to. There was no need to compile the Qur'an cover to cover. The entire Qur'an was written down, and the entire Qur'an was memorized, but it was in scattered form during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we'll continue along this in our next episode. Returning to our rules of tajweed, in our last episode we were talking about the rules of nun sakin and tanween. We now move on. This is the third of our episodes related to the rules of nun sakin and tanween, and we were discussing in our last episode the rules of idgham. We said how many types of idgham are there? There's idgham with ghunna and idgham without ghunna. And last episode we discussed the idgham without ghunna. Well, in today's episode we'll discuss the idgham with ghunna, and there are four letters that occur after the nun sakin or tanween which necessitate an idgham with ghunna. And these are the letters of ya, nun, mim, and waw. Okay? If any of these four letters occurs after the nun sakin or tanween, well, we merge what is before it with what is after it, like we did last time. Yeah. But the only difference is the ghunna. What is the ghunna sound again? The nasal sound. It comes from the nose. Yeah. Okay? So when we have any of these four letters, ya, noon, meem, or waw, after any noon sakina or any tanween, then we are going to merge. What was the merging? Merging is you take what is before and what is after and you drop the end sound directly. And you merge it, but the only difference with last episode is we actually have a ghunna. Let's give some examples here. We have a man yabda'u. We have a noon sakina followed by a ya. And a ya is a letter of idgham with ghunna. So we pronounce this as man yabda'u, man yabda'u, man. Notice there is no man. It's immediately the mim associates with the ya, and you drop the noon sound. But you have a ghunna. And that's the nasal sound. May. If you close your nose, you will not be able to. But you can't do it. Because that is the ghunna sound. Okay? Likewise, يَوْمَئِذٍ. There's a tanween here. يَتَفَرَّقُون. So the tanween followed by a ya.
يَوْمَئِذٍ يَتَفَرَّقُون. يَوْمَئِذٍ.
You notice the ذِي. There's a ghunna. Okay? And there is no clear end sound. Likewise, the next example of min ni'mah and azimin nahnu. Both of them, there's a tanween followed by a noon. Okay, this is in a noon sakinah, this is in a tanween. Okay, min ni'matin, min. You have a noon followed by, noon sakinah followed by a noon. You drop this n sound, you take this meme and you associate it or you merge it with that noon and you add a ghunna. Min ni'mah. Likewise, over here we have عظيمٍ نحن. We have a tanween followed by another noon. عظيمٍ نحن. Same thing occurs over here. An example with the meme. We have noon sakina followed by a meme. Once again, we drop the noon, we take the hamza, and we associate it with the meme, we merge it with the meme, and we add a ghunna. أفإن مت أفإن مت. So we drop the noon and we put the hamza along with the meme, and that is our idgham with ghunna. Likewise over here we have a tanween followed by a meme. قريب مجيب قريب مجيب. We have a tanween followed by a meme. So we drop the n sound. We don't say قريب مجيب. We drop the n sound and we merge the tanween immediately onto the meme with a ghunna. And our final letter is that of the wa. Wow. We have min wali. Likewise, we drop the noon because the waw is of the letters of idgham with ghunna. Min wali. Min wali. Likewise, over here we have a tanween followed by a wa. Anka lahu wa jahima. Anka lahu wa jahima. You merge the tanween along with the waw and you move on. You don't pronounce the n sound and you have a ghunna. Here now it is important to point out that idgham only occurs in two words. There cannot be idgham in the same word. Okay? You cannot have idgham in one word. Idgham must be that at the end of one word you have the noon, sakin, or tanween, and the beginning of the other word you have the letters of idgham. If it occurs in the same word, there is no idgham. Notice our examples here. The word dunya. Dunya, this world. The noon is sakin, followed by aya. Right? Do you make idgham? Duya? No, you don't. Because it's in one word. So you don't have idgham in one word. Likewise, sinwan. No idgham. There's a noon sakin followed by a waw. Sinwan, sinwan. You pronounce the noon. In this case, the ruling would be idhar. You make it clear. Okay? Without any ghunna, you make the noon clear and you move on. Why? Because it's in one word. Likewise, bunyanahum. 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 There's a noon sakin followed by a ya. You do not merge anything here because it is in one word. Even though there's a noon sakin followed by a ya, you are not allowed to do any merging because it is in one word. So remember, idgham occurs in how many words?
Two.
It must be that the end of one word is a noon sakin or tanween, and the beginning of the second word is one of the letters of idgham. What are the letters of idgham? All of them?
Six.
Six letters, right? They have six letters of idgham. The six letters of idgham are yarmalun, or if you arrange them another way, you say lar yanmu. If you arrange it away, in a different way, you have a nice cut in the middle. And that cut will tell you which are the letters with ghunna and which are the letters without ghunna. Okay? The same six letters, yarmalun, lar yanmu. But if you arrange it in this way, it might be easier for you to remember. Remember all of these letters, why do we put them in a word? So you keep on repeating them. We have so many examples before. Who can give me an example before where we combined a lot of letters to memorize them? خُصَّ ضَغْطٍ قِضْ. Exactly. Another example? فَحَثَّهُ شَخْصٌ سَكَتْ. We didn't do that actually. It's a more advanced rule. But yes, إِبْغِي حَجَّكَ وَخِفْ عَقِيمَهُ. And how about the letters of قَلْقَلَة?
قُطُبِجَدْ.
So all of these letters, the purpose is the ulama have just devised something for you. It's a mnemonic, you call it in English. You keep on repeating it until you memorize these particular letters. So the six letters of idgham are لَرْ يَنْمُ. Just keep on saying لَرْ يَنْمُ, لَرْ يَنْمُ. And when you say it, you will realize that the لَمْ رَ separates from the yanmu, and that's a convenient separation if you want to separate between the idgham without ghunna, which is the lam and the ra, and the idgham with ghunna, which is the yanmu. Okay? Let us now move on to our practice recitation of Surah Al-Ghashiyah. Surah Al-Ghashiyah is the 88th surah of the Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
هل أتاك حديث الغاشية؟
هل أتاك حديث الغاشية؟
وجوه يومئذ خاشعة.
وجوه يومئذ خاشعة.
Notice here we have the وجوه. We have a تنوين on the ha, right? Followed by a?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what is the ruling? Idgham with ghunna, because the ya, right up here we have with ghunna. Wujuhui, like that. How about yawma idhin? We have another tanween. What is that followed by? Clarity, because it's followed by a kha. And kha is of the letters of the throat, which will be a clear thing. Yawma idhin khashia.
Amilatun nasiba.
Amilatun nasiba.
Okay, we have a tanween followed by a noon. Right? What do we do here now?
Idgham
with ghunna. Amilatun. That's an idgham with a ghunna. Okay? Nasiba. Here's an interesting point. We have an alif here. Okay? The alif. Will it be heavy or light?
Light.
Why? The noon is light. But how about the sad after it?
It has a kasra.
Okay, but the sad, is it related to the alif or not?
No.
Many people make a mistake and they say amilatun nasiba, nasiba, because they think the sad will make it heavy. But when it comes to the alif, to make it light or heavy, nasiba or nasiba, you look at the letter before and you don't worry about the letter after when it comes to the alif.
Tasla naran hamia.
Tasla naran hamia.
We have naran, a tanween. What did we do here?
Idhar,
because of the
letter,
it's followed by a ha.
Tusqa min aynin aniya.
Tusqa min aynin aniya.
Okay, we have a tanween of a noon, aynin, and then we have a hamza. So once again, it'll be idhar. Suppose we went on, we didn't stop here, and what would we say if we went on with aniyatin? How would we pronounce it then? Okay, so because there's a tanween followed by alam, so we would have idgham without ghunna. Let me say that for you.
Tusqa min aynin aniyatin laysa lahum ta'amun illa min dhari'.
We have over here the aniyatil. We dropped the noon sound, we emerged it without a ghunna. Then we have ta'amun, which is
Idhar
because of the hamza after it. Okay, so repeat after me.
Laysa lahum ta'amun illa min dhari'.
Laysa lahum ta'amun illa min dhari'.
La yusminu wa la yughni min ju'.
لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع.
وجوه يومئذ ناعمة.
وجوه يومئذ ناعمة.
Okay, who can tell me what are the rulings here? وجوه, yes, go ahead. Idgham with ghunna, because there's a tanween followed by a ya. And then yawma idhin, again the same thing, we have a tanween followed by a noon. Yawma idhin na'ima. Suppose we went on,
na'imatun li sa'iha radiyah.
Na'imatul, what will be the ruling here? Without ghunna. Okay, because there's a tanween followed by a la. So we have the merging, the idgham, but we have it without ghunna.
في جنة عالية.
في جنة عالية.
Likewise, we have جنتين عالية. What would be here?
إظهار.
We look at the letter after it always. Again, it's very simple. It's not that complicated. All you have to do is you look at the particular letter after the noon sakina, after the tanween, and then you see which letter follows it, and you pronounce the ruling according to that. With this, we come to the end of this episode. We have one more ruling for Noon Sakinah Tanween, which we'll take in our next episode. Until then, recite the Qur'an properly, وَرَتِّلْ قُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا, and we'll try to be in the company of As-Safaratul Kiram, of the Holy Angels. I hope to see you next time. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.